and due to the high cost of land. Right now, the RAD program is set to increase people's quality of living so that we can make structural improvements to the facilities and the surroundings. What is also important is that we have heavy case management wrapping around services to the family, so there isn't any displacement, no one is left behind or falls through the cracks. Now, what is also very critical in order for us to transition into a positive place, so we don't have displacement, is that the families that are in the community feel supported, and they're also educated on what exactly this transformation is happening. It's a partnership between a private developer, the housing authority, and then the tenant residents. Funding from RAD comes from the federal government. A lot of the structural improvements are also going to be brought into play by private developers. They will come in and manage the rent collection of the my time up?
She's keeping me on time.
Oh, okay.
8 minutes for each topic, and I'm
Okay. All right. Well, I'll stop there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anybody else want to address this? Yes, sir. Tell me your name. Sorry, Tony Kelly, Canterbury District 10 Supervisor. And a lot of issues I think are coming up in my head, not just about the RAD program. So I'll try to hit through a few of them briefly. First, in the RAD program, one of the issues that NCIU, which has a lot of workers in the housing, is concerned about is that if you look at the agreements that are being developed in the RAD program, there's still some sketchiness about how this program is fully funded. If these things are underfunded for the management now, how are they going to be fully funded in the future? And there's not a lot of explanation about that. But in those drafting agreements, there's a lot of specificity about how the land would actually revert to Wells Fargo if things don't work out right under the financing. And so that makes folks very nervous. And I think that that's a legitimate concern as these things move forward. Second, the OpenSF program, which does apply to different housing projects, also has a similar problem, because one of the things slowing those down is a lack of private financing or the difficulty of getting enough money to do the full-on construction. We've been promised the HOPE-SF program for some time now, and there's even still talk about one of these things will go next, Sunnydale or Potrero Terrace and Annex. Would it kill us to do both? I think it wouldn't, but in fact it's killing us to delay any further, and we actually need to use public financing much more aggressively so that we're not using market rate housing and commercial bank financing to build this. But then there's also a problem with city-funded housing. The Eviction Defense Collaborative did a report last year that found that one in four evictions in the city last year was in housing that was funded by the city of San Francisco. So the biggest evictor of the city of San Francisco is the city of San Francisco. Wow. And one in three evictions last year was of an African American. So that's your out-migration right there, one powerful indicator of the out-migration. And some of that has to be happening with public housing, because just do the math about where our populations are, and so there is displacement happening in public housing. We don't have uniform eviction standards anywhere in the various programs in the city. We need to do a much better job on that, and the board needs to do a much better job of oversight, because generations of management of the housing authority have proven that they can't do the job.
I have a follow-up for Leah.
Yeah, I brought a document because I kind of anticipated this. I actually have a document that indicates the number of evictions that have happened both with the San Francisco Housing Authority as well as HOPE-SF property. We can circulate it for the audience. And the city is not the main evictor moving folks out. I call into question the source and the validity of those particular numbers, and I certainly brought documentation to support the position. The other thing that I wanted to also acknowledge is that the draft EIR report for Potrero Hill is actually going to be coming out in the next 2 weeks, and then an additional 4 weeks is going to be coming out, Sunnydale is going to be coming out. So it's a little bit unfair characterization that the project is stalled. It's actually moving through the legislative process. That draft EIR is going to be made public, as I said, in the next month. And then it will be open for a period of 30 days for commentary from the general public, so people can pay attention, make critiques, make comments, and really engage in this particular project. Because this development, this rebuild, is absolutely significant, not just for the people that live in public housing, but for the people that live in the surrounding areas. Because what we're talking about is really in transforming the entire neighborhood. So that's really important for us to keep that in mind.
So which neighborhood gets transformed next year? The one that gets moved forward, this one doesn't.
I defer to the moderator.
I'm sorry, I've got to stretch by my own phone.
Oh. Which one was it? I'm trying to ask a question. Which neighborhood gets to move forward? Which one gets to have a rebuild? Which one has to wait for the 2020?
Well, actually, it's not a matter of which goes forward, which goes back. It's, the EIRs are taking shape, and they, like I said, whichever one finishes the project first, process first is what goes through. So it's a natural attrition. It's not one versus the other.
Great. I want to hear from some of the school board folks on this. I'll come back to you, I promise. But I want to hear from some of the school. This side of the table has been quiet so far, so I need you all to jump in where you can on this question. And Ed, I promise you I'll come right back to you.
I don't know if you've necessarily been quiet by choice, but
okay.
Jamal Austin, candidate for school board here in San Francisco. One of the things I will say, just the key here in terms of the rebuild and in terms of what the changes are coming with public housing is the preparation part. Preparation, the education and skill building part that is going to need to happen with the cultural shifts and changes of how we deal with public housing. We're going to have to provide better job training opportunities for our communities to make sure that they have opportunities for every career choice that is available. Looking at the data in terms of whether jobs are in San Francisco, hospitality, healthcare, building and construction, particularly and primarily in Bay Area. So, being aggressive about training and preparing individuals for jobs. Second is the education pipeline that has to come out of USD. So we need to make sure that our children, not just public housing, but in general in San Francisco, are prepared for the jobs that are going to be available and prepared to go directly to work if higher education is not their focus when they are going to high school. So we're going to need to bring career and college exploration, vocation programs in preschools, starting with preschool through high school. And so we need to focus on making sure that our communities are prepared because the education components, and I'm not just talking about school education, but I'm talking about building skills in general to prepare you to be able to take advantage of these opportunities. They're going to need to learn how to budget and save. That's going to be an important piece with this shift in public housing. They're going to need to know how to get and earn a living via a job and career, a career track. And so those are the things that we have to focus on in preparation for this. That is going to be real key and real important with the shifts and the changes that are coming. It's really reculturalization and education for our community. Someone who was born and lived in public housing for years, right there in West Point, which we now call Huntersville, and also lived in Pearl Hill on 25th Street for years as well. There has to be an understanding of what we need to do to be people who pay rent, what we need to do to be people who can save and prepare for our future.
Thank
so
you.
That preparation piece is the focus.
Thank you. As I think about this whole panel, I'm thinking I wish we had on this board of an illustration saying 3.9% in terms of the blackout migration of San Francisco. So we can talk about preparation, et cetera. I'm not responding to you directly. But all about conversation, I sort of like, where are the kids who will be educated and prepared if there's a pattern about migration? So I do see how housing does reflect back to the education piece. And so supervisors and potential school board members seem to be impacted by the issue of housing as much as education policy is. So I'm wondering, how are you going to, what is there to be done in terms of just stopping the bleeding from the out-migration, if that's possible, to have kids in front of you in seats to education? Anybody want to jump on that? Ed first and then the next two.
Well,
I promise you, I'll come back. I promise you.
Working in conjunction with SEIU that we started to do was actually begin a lawsuit. Because what we discovered was that the only thing that was going to compel the city to respond correctly to this issue was a lawsuit. I mean, no amount of, you know, speaking to them, talking to them, beseeching them, begging them, has done the job. And it's interesting, and I want to reiterate the point that I made at the very beginning. Everywhere there has been privatization of public housing across the country, there has been some level of displacement. The level of displacement is directly related to how well or how prepared the residents are, eviction defense money, and just generally understanding what their due process right is.
Let me tell the audience, if you have questions, you can send me a piece of paper with a question on it, and I'll be glad. But we're not going to have questions from the floor, just so you all know.
Understanding the distinction between HOPE-SF and RAG, that's clear to me. The reason I pointed to the Hope SF and the 150 evictions that we filed the lawsuit on to get an injunction, I pointed to that because that speaks to a larger issue around the dysfunction of the housing authority. They have an operating system on their computers, or MS-DOS operating system, right? It doesn't properly track information and keep accurate information. So folks are consistently confronted with eviction notices that is not of their making, right? And having spoke to someone from a RAD project today, I got a phone call from someone living in a RAD project where they got an eviction notice, and I had someone living in the Hope SF project that called me today, where it was an arbitrary kind of thing where they were able to show me their receipts for having paid their rent on time. Yet they're continuing to give you eviction notice.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Supervisor Campos, I'm sorry.
Yeah, you know, I want to step back because I actually think that in many respects what's happened to public housing illustrates the what's happening in San Francisco. In a way, it is a perfect example. I'm really appreciative of this debate because I've been talking about the issue of inequality as the issue facing San Francisco. It's not just that African Americans are 3.9%, but it's the fact that San Francisco, on one hand, is the wealthiest city in the entire country, and also has the fastest growing inequality in the entire country. 6 months ago, we were second behind Atlanta. I believe we're number one now. So if we were an independent country, San Francisco would be among the most unequal countries in the entire world, right? And so the wealthiest city in the country has left behind many people. And let's be honest, the African-American community, more than anyone else, has been impacted by that. And what's happening with public housing is a perfect illustration of how the African-American community and public housing, as an example, have not been a priority for San Francisco. We have been losing a community that went from being in double digits to now 3.9%. And yet, what is the strategy that's coming out of City Hall? I don't know that anyone really knows what public housing is going to look like, and it is privatization. But what's remarkable about it is that the people who are the most impacted, the residents of public housing, are not really involved to the extent that any resident should be involved. And, you know, I appreciate, Ed, that was talking about what happened last year. You know, when we were talking about the budget, I put forward a proposal to have a citywide organizing of tenants in public housing across the city. Because as we have seen in the context of SROs, single room occupancy hotels, when the tenants in these hotels are organized, things get better. But I could not get a single person on the Board of Supervisors besides me to say that they actually wanted that level of organizing in their districts. And so when that happened, what did I do? I said, okay, you know what? If you don't want to have it in your district, then how about letting me have it in my district so that the people in my district at least can organize and be ready? And so I don't know what the future looks like, and I actually do have concerns about the privatization. But one thing has to happen is we need to empower the residents, because unless the residents are involved, whatever it looks like, it's not going to meet their needs.
Great. And I want you to give some thought to the future, because that's the last question for everybody at the end of this discussion, is how you project and visualize San Francisco about 15 years from now, which is why.
What we're providing to them academically with while they're in their school environment, but what are the services that we're providing them to make sure that they're ready to come to the classroom ready to learn? So it's not just those 6 hours during the day, but it's those morning hours and it's those afternoon hours. It's how we feed them. We make sure, I mean, we have kids that come to our schools just for lunch. You know, they're not coming in for anything else. We have kids that stay home and don't even come to school because their parents aren't thinking about, well, you know what, it's not that important today. I need you to stay home and watch your sister. You know, like, these are the kinds of things that as educators we're not thinking about, but it plays a huge role in the outcomes of our children. So not only is it the trust in building the housing, but it's also the trust in providing the proper supports and education that our kids need in order to get out of these cycles of poverty and to get out of public housing and to be, you know, to actually be able to have a fruitful life in this very expensive city. So the second piece I'll say is just around what the school district is capable of in terms of helping to support affordable housing. So as the chair of Buildings and Grounds, we were able to actually finally move a piece of property located at 1950 Mission contribution that a school district has that does not do anywhere across the country. Where we're thinking about how can we provide affordable housing, not only for our parents, but where our teachers and our paraprofessionals could potentially qualify for housing as well. And so, you know, what happens in housing has a huge impact on our children, social and emotional, and we need to be paying attention to it. And we're doing some urban planning, and I convened a meeting to have planning, OEWD, workforce development together with the folks over the school district, because we know the expansion that's happening in our district. So we know the expansion that's happening in our city, because we don't know if we're going to be able to even house the kids that are coming in the schools that we currently have in our community. So if you're telling me that our growth in our city is going to grow by 200,000 over the next 25 years, what am I going to do with those families and those children?
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Trevor McNeil. I'm also running for school board. I'm a public school teacher, and I've experienced getting really excited about teaching a student. They're fitting into my classroom, and then they're gone. They've had to leave the city, and they can't afford it. And it's that kind of disruption to a young person's life is incalculable. It's really awful. And it's awful for teachers and communities as well. I think for the school board, leadership is going to be a big part of this. Well, the privatization of public education is a very real and very, I think, evil threat to the benefits of public education. So we as school board members who can't afford to build huge amounts of public housing, we do have to say, hey, there is a public benefit to public education. Hey, there is a public benefit to all of our kids in our city so that they can learn equally. I think that is an important voice that the school board can have in that discussion.
Let me ask, yeah. And it's related to your question, you can answer it, anybody can. Are there properties that the San Francisco Unified School District owns now that aren't operating that can be refurbished and reclaimed, and instead of having to start from ground zero, can they build on existing work material?
We do have surplus property, unless we have an understanding of what the progress is going to be in the city,
progress, what do you mean?
So all of the growth, all the economic growth, all the housing growth, the population growth. So we're not prepared to sell our properties if we may later on invest. Can you imagine them trying to buy back property? As a governmental agency, that's
just
not
the
work.
And we're just not designed for that. We're designed to teach kids.
Okay.
I also
want
to quickly.
Do you agree with that, Ed? They're designed to teach kids, not to develop.
I agree that the population in San Francisco is going to grow.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point in time, these properties can be used. So I agree with Hydro in that sense. I mean, it's a tough question.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Trevor, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I just wanted to, I have to leave early tonight. I do hope that we're all spending every single year. So how is it that we should be doing this smarter enough?
Thank you so much, Mark. Let me go ahead. I'll have you guys speak because you haven't had a word yet, but I'm trying to get to the next question. In fact, let you just have to speak to this question.
I would love to speak to this question. Okay, I'll make it brief. My name is Jamie Wolf. I'm running for Board of Education. So as a school administrator behaviorist that works at a non-public school here in San Francisco, many of my students are in public housing, and we're talking about visions here. I envision a San Francisco where my students are not moving from house to house due to infestations of rats.
And that's the reality now?
Mold.
That's the reality?
That's the reality of many of the children I'm working with. And when I see these children move from house to house, I see behaviors that you don't regularly see at their kind of baseline behaviors. That influences lesson instruction and absorption of materials. So it influences education. So I envision a world where our children have stable housing because it'll just help education.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Less than 30 seconds. I think that the school district definitely should not be in the business of real estate. However, I think any responsible bureaucracy has to adapt with the changes in the environment. We should not be selling property. I would not recommend that. But what about rent? What about leasing? What about developing property to turn it into something that we can make profit off of? Those are the conversations that we want to try to improve as well.
I think you have to end up, Demolita.
Yeah, and I apologize that my supervisor is not.
Your name?
My name is Sonny Angulo, and I am representing Supervisor Kim tonight. She's on Treasure Island for her community office hours. So I apologize she isn't here. And just to Ed's point, it's true when we think of SFUSD, we don't think of it as a real estate agency and it can be put in that position, but for the surplus property that is available, one thing that I know, when Jane was on the Board of Education and now, and when she was on the Board of Hydra, and now we're
affordable housing that would be developed for our families, for our kids, and our schools. And that's a viable use of that property. And I know that there was some controversy over, you know, we should be building teacher housing, this is what we should be doing. Unfortunately, under the Fair Housing Act, it's a state requirement that, you know, we cannot designate criteria that people can be housed according to their job. But we can do employer housing, and that's something that, you know, the city should continue to investigate.
Thank you so much. Did you have a comment? Tell me your name.
My name is Emily Murase. I'm currently Vice President of the Board of Education. I'm taking the second term on the board. And I have worked with the Housing Director, Henry Alvarez, and now Barbara Smith. In my day job, I report to the mayor as head of the Department of the Status of Women. And one of the topics that we take up is domestic violence. SFUSD serves all kids, homeless kids, marginalized, housed kids, and kids in the housing project. And what we see is a lot of trauma. And some of that trauma is generated through domestic violence. And I work with Commander Lazar here on addressing domestic violence. And I want to just recognize Maria Cohen for her leadership. She has made sure that there are now two new domestic violence advocates in the public housing complex so that families can access resources there so we can build stronger families. Just two other points, teacher housing. So it's important that our teachers are also able to live in San Francisco. And so there is now a working group with the union, with our staff, and the Mayor's Office of Housing to talk about a possible housing subsidy for teachers. And my final point is touched on out-migration of African Americans. And African American kids are very much central topic of discussion in the school board. This year, for the first time, we are staffing a dedicated African-American achievement staff person. We have, as of last year, an African-American parent advisory council. And I hope you will all come and celebrate to our African-American honor roll program, where we recognize over 1,000 African-American students with a GPA of Houston or higher.
Thank you so much.
I touched on the complications of land swap. I think that's really important to highlight. And also she spoke about employer housing. Can the school district just be a developer? No, but the city has and can be. And we've got housing trust fund. We've got money that we have went to the voters to get permission to begin to build affordable housing. So it is conceivable that we can begin to partner, the school district can partner with the city to develop housing for people who work for the San Francisco Unified School District. And that's more than just teachers. That's also paraprofessionals. That could also be janitors. It could be a whole host of things. And then Emily Morase mentioned about trauma. One thing that is really significant that I want to compliment members on the school board and the advocates on is that we're going to be opening up a brand new middle school in the Bayview community that's going to be targeted, just focused on on technology. 21st century technology is going to be a beautiful, exquisite building. And also what's also remarkable is that we're going to have mental health care workers on site. There'll be, a dental clinic as well. So what you're actually seeing is are people consistently talking to each other that I do believe in the past we have not done. We're talking to each other and we are trying to deal with a young student realizing that they're connected to families and that we need to provide wraparound services to these families. Dr. Taylor.
Thank you. No,
I would just like to say that, you know, the equity debate as it is here is not about one person. It's not about people sitting up here. It's not about us in this room. It's about the people out in San Francisco, in the community, who couldn't be here tonight. But we can make it accessible for them, and we can help them know what's going on here and what's being said. And the way we can do that is by, you know, instead of any other debate where we ask you to silence your phones and turn them off and turn off your electronics, we encourage you to take out your phones, take out your cameras, take pictures of what's going on here, you know, do like they do in sports games, give the people out there the play-by-play on Twitter, you know, who do you think is winning? Who said something funny? You know, I think that that's the best way to do this, and that's the way to make sure that everybody, and especially people who can't be here, can access what's going on and help access what's going on in their community. So, you know, take out your phones, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, whatever, hashtag the equity debate, and help people around the city know what's going on.
James, why don't you take us into our discussion about secondary?
Thank you. So here's the question, and then I'll get to the context. The question is this, this is what you'll be asked. How do we shift that? And here's the answer. San Francisco, and it kind of segues over something that Supervisor Cohen said. San Francisco is experiencing a tech boom. The influx of tech workers into San Francisco has created job growth for low-skilled workers and chronically unemployed and underemployed people, but mostly in the service industry. And we've yet to see a real pipeline for minority communities to high-paying tech jobs. We know Ben Jealous, who used to be head of the NACP, is moving to the area or back to the area to try to facilitate that. And it's sad that most people don't know about Roy Clay Sr., who's the heart and soul of Hewlett-Packard and created his first software. He was a black man who's 85 years old and got chased out of Ferguson, Missouri in 1943 by the police and told him, nigga, don't let us catch you in this town again. And he fled, finished his schoolwork in St. Louis and then fled to San Francisco and made a life for himself. And so he's the foundation of the Silicon Valley, at least in terms of Hewlett-Packard. And we don't know about his history. But I want to follow up and ask, Twitter's recent diversity report revealed employees are white. At Twitter, 59% of U.S. Of its employees are white, while 29% are Asian, 2% are African American or black, 3% are Hispanic, and 72% of the leadership roles are occupied by white employees. I'm curious as to how you all would imagine a shift or try to influence a shift in these dynamics of Supervisor Cumberland.
Let me say this, that I think that the issue of tech goes to the very heart of this question of inequality. And I think that we have to be, we cannot talk about equity, inequity, and not talk about what happened at the Board of Supervisors on Tuesday. Because that illustrates...
But those who weren't there.
So let me tell you, that illustrates the point. Let me say this, that those of us who have been saying from the very beginning that we welcome tech, but we simply want tech to play by the same rules as everyone else, have been targeted by some in the tech and some of the political establishment to be anti-tech. What happened at the Board of Supervisors is that the Board of Supervisors voted to legalize the practices of Airbnb. And let me say this, that I'm for home sharing. I am for legalizing short-term rentals. I think there's a place for it. But we did that with legislation that President Chu and introduced, Supervisor Cohen and others supported. They did so without the very basic requirement that Airbnb actually do something that everyone in this room does and that every business in San Francisco does, which is to pay their fair share, to pay the $25 million in back taxes that they owe the city. And my amendment, which went down 5-6, and I want to thank Supervisor Kim, you know, whose representative is here, for voting for it, went down. And so what kind of message we're sending is this, that all of us have to play by a certain set of rules, and the tech industry can play by a different set of rules. And we have given tax break after tax break to Twitter, now to Airbnb, without requiring anything in return. And they talk about, you know, the leadership of the Board of Supervisors talked about how we created jobs in San Francisco. I'm sorry, but the jobs that have been created are not jobs that were created by a lot of people of color, or a lot of people of color. When only 6% of the tech workers are African American and Latino, you ask yourself, how is it that local government can make those choices? And the context of a crisis,
Can you imagine what we could do with $25 million that we left on the table? Can you imagine what we can do? I mean, I'm running for the 17th Assembly District. Can you imagine what we can do in the 17th Assembly District? Can you imagine what you could do with $25 million in District 10?
Yes.
You know, we were talking about public housing. Anyone knows that the federal government is not going to give you the money you need to address the issue of public housing. We're going to have to dip into local funding. Prop C has set aside some money that is supposed to go to affordable housing, but can you imagine what $25 million could do for our public housing in San Francisco? And yet, the Board of Supervisors 2 days ago voted against requiring this company to pay its fair share of taxes. That is the problem. That's a fundamental problem and a fundamental illustration of how inequity goes to the very heart of how government is operating in San Francisco. And unless we change that and we actually make these tech companies like everyone else pay their fair share of taxes, we can talk about niceties all we want, but we're not going to be able to close this gap, this inequality, without that.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Aaron. I'm a campaign staffer for Chief Assembly, and unfortunately, as David mentioned, he had to rush.
Say that again, slowly.
My first day. apologize for the nerves. My name is Aaron. I'm a staffer for David Chief Assembly. Supervisor Chu, as he mentioned, had to rush off to a prior engagement, but I'm here representing him. Just a couple of things, if I can respond to some of the comments that were made by Supervisor Campos. First and foremost, Supervisor Campos was framing the short-term rental legislation as something that does not require Airbnb to pay tax to the city, and that is a complete misnomer of what this legislation is. In fact, this legislation, for the first time, requires home sharers, whether using Airbnb, whether using other short-term rental services, to pay the very same hotel tax that any other hospitality.
About back taxes.
Which is what you're referring to, which is what I'm going to get to in a second. The notion that this legislation doesn't require or gets them off the hook from paying back taxes, again, is a misnomer. As David, you mentioned, Supervisor Chu asked for on Tuesday, this legislation requires them to pay taxes for the first time. It does not preclude them from paying back taxes, but as you mentioned, that is not a decision that this legislation can solve. That is something that has to be decided by the city attorney, by the city treasurer, whether those back taxes are something that can legally be required by the city.
Actually, the city attorney drafted language that said that legally we had every right to include in the legislation that required them, language approved by the city attorney, to pay their back taxes. David Chu voted against it. Olivia Cohen voted against it.
Again, you're framing this as something, with all due respect, that is allowing a major tech company, a San Francisco company, to avoid having to pay the same taxes that other companies have to pay.
Yep.
When what we know from this legislation, and we know that Airbnb has just started paying these taxes, and that's going to bring in, we're estimating $12 to $15 million of new taxes to our city coffers every year. So the idea that we're letting Airbnb off the hook, that they're not paying their fair share, again, is the exact opposite of what this legislation was accomplishing.
Is Ken? Tony, I'm sorry.
There was a decision from the city treasurer 2 years ago that yes, Airbnb is on the hook for these taxes, and somehow there's been a failure to actually act on that. Airbnb has been ignoring it, and there needs to be an increase in leverage. This is one of the classic powers of the Board of Supervisors. They have the unlimited power of inquiry. They have audit and oversight responsibilities. They're the last word on the budget. So they have the power in this legislation to mandate that these taxes would be paid. So it's not just saying Airbnb is slow. So is City Hall. So is the mayor's office. So whatever reason that these things are not going collected, the board does have the power to do it, and the board chose on Tuesday to not exercise that power.
Supervisor Cohen, they seem to be throwing these curves at you and they're taking them like a good boxer. Can you respond?
Well, yeah, I would say this. We are legislators. We always have, well, we have more, we don't just have one bite at the apple. And the legislation that was voted on, and let's also be clear, there was hours of testimony, there was hours of public comment and a lot of information that was presented. Now, one thing that was not presented and one very significant partner that was not present in this entire discussion was the tax collector. was our city tax collector. On the floor, I did request that the tax collector come because it's still unclear as to whether or not the dollar figure Supervisor Complex puts out $25 million. And I think I even asked you where you got that number from.
It's actually based on what the ruling by the tax collector and the estimate from Airbnb as to what they're paying annually. So you extrapolate and use their numbers to 30 months, you get to $25 million
okay.
using their numbers.
So my issue is not to dispute. I'm actually all for going out to get the taxes in just because the legislation, let's also be clear, the legislation was passed to regulate an industry that has been operating illegal for what, at least 5 years. So we needed to provide some kind of regulatory framework and context on it around something that's happening to protect people that are coming and staying into the in these units of these of the temporary stay. So it's not because the back taxes were not addressed yesterday on Tuesday doesn't necessarily mean that it will not be addressed in the future.
I mean, look, a business cannot open in San Francisco without paying a permit. The city won't let you open if you owe the city $150 in permits. And in this case, they owe us millions of dollars, $25 million by their own numbers.
Are you doing anything to follow up?
Well, the city tax collector.
My amendment was failed because they voted against it.
You know, I would be interested on whether Supervisor Cohen or Supervisor Chu would be willing to sponsor legislation to go after those.
Yes.
So that should be something going out of your
office. Absolutely. As a matter of fact, I mean, those are my comments on the board.
So how soon should we expect it?
Well, I can get a meeting with the same.
Yeah, I heard that, right?
Yeah.
Right. We're running out of time. Time is an issue, so we're running out of time. So let me move us on to the next question.
Can we see one piece on technology for the young people? I think that's a very big debate to have. And I guess for us, the question becomes how do we take advantage of the technology companies and what the jobs are going to look like for our young people. And if you actually hire kids out of SFUSD, the diversification of the workforce will look very, very different than it currently does. So, you know, there's several things that I just want to be able to point out. So, you know, we've Wi-Fi'd all of the middle schools. We've put devices in their hands. We're doing support services for our teachers so that they know how to do curriculum on devices so that all of our kids have access in our middle school. We use organizations like Internet Essentials to ensure that families have opportunities to get on there. You know, we're sending kids to a variety of different places so that they have internships and job opportunities during the summer so they can get at least an experience of what some of these jobs are.
But where does this have to come from? Where does this vision have to come from? The school board, the mayor? Where does this vision
come from? This comes from both. I mean, exactly what Mark is talking about and what we've been doing in the mayor's office, which is leveraging the mayor's office in order to get opportunities for our young people. We're talking about 7,500 jobs that we've done. We're talking about Zynga. We did this thing with Zynga where they opened up a gaming academy for us at Thurgood Marshall and at Balboa High School. It's the number one elective that's been chosen at both of those high schools. We embed coding into our STEM curriculum. So there's a lot of things that are happening, and you have to do that in partnership.
Sir, I haven't heard a word from you. Tell me your name and John?
Yes.
So okay, John, can you jump in on this?
Well, I mean, for one, we have a daughter that goes to Winter Hoover, and she was part of the technology, what Hadi just mentioned about, and actually being a part of the tech room that I used to work at, a small company, startup company with a friend of mine, that we integrated with the kids and trying to educate them on getting outside the box and going to a different place of not just being stuck on the regular curriculum that's in the school, but teaching them high technology so they can advance. We have a young man that went to Mission High School, and then we put him in the program. He designed his own game. And right now, he sold that game to ESPN, and I don't know much, but he sold it. But that's just supposed to show you the level of the education system where the kids are being placed at and how they can grow. And if we create that and keep that in mind, we can develop more young men, more young women to go further.
Thank you.
Just to take this conversation and keep going, what the school district is doing, the technology boom that is taking place here in San Francisco, we have to be educating our children differently about different things. And the school district just 2 years ago started a new division in the district called the STEM department, Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math, and has placed millions of dollars.
But we're talking about inequality.
And I know that.
I'm on the board of directors of the San Francisco Achievers. Hold your thoughts. And that's the mentoring program that some of you may know about San Francisco Achievers. Here's Theo right here. How do you bridge? I mean, we work together that the performance of African American young men in the school district is dismal. You know, I mean, we're having a hard time finding his average performance. So how are you going to go from this kind of negative to the positive of making these people viable, flourishing workers in this?
What do you got to say?
You know, this has been something that has been concentrated primarily in the Tenderloin, but that community has really been responsible for its own, policy initiatives, community policing, the idea, the public safety model to basically remove all of the parking on the unit block of turf was actually an idea that was put forward by the community in one of their community meetings. And that, I see some residents here tonight.
Just really quick then, a couple of things. You were just talking about other things that Kamala Harris did while she was here, and the other was starting a model program, which she has talked and done statewide now, which is around truancy, which is, don't just kick kids out of school and because they're truant or because they're not showing up at school, but let's go figure out what's going on in their lives. And that is the conversation that is happening more in the district, to step out into community. What's going on in your life so that you're not coming to school? So we as a district are taking that on as well. And the last thing I was just going to say is, again, about young people who are incarcerated today. We are the only, check me here, commissioners, we are the only school district in the United States of America that has a school in our juvenile justice building. We are the only school district in the United States of America that is taking the time and the resources and putting money into educating our children while they are incarcerated today. We are working to better their lives so that when they do get out, so that when they do find themselves back in, families and in community, that they have schools, they have skills to get themselves moving forward.
Thank you. Yes. Tell me there again.
Jamie Wolf.
Thank you, Jamie.
Candidate for school board. Something we haven't mentioned at all in the past hour and 35 minutes, we have not mentioned something that cuts across every socioeconomic line, color line, district line, LGBT issues. Mm-hmm. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, questioning, intersex. We are talking about safety. We're talking about generational poverty. A lot of the homeless people you see on the streets are LGBT people that were pushed out of their homes. That's why they don't have homes. That's why they're homeless right now. What about same-sex couples that are trying to access services and being pushed away? That also happens here in San Francisco. As a trans-identified person, I also suffer, or I am also exposed to transphobia and different kinds of phobias. So we have a lot of people that are aware of this. Thank you, Supervisor Campos. Just led a whole bunch of people to Facebook. There's people that are out there changing. As the head of Trans March here in San Francisco, we make it a priority to make sure that we fund the Transgender Intersex Justice Project, because trans women of color are extremely subjected to levels of violence that include injury and or death. It is an epidemic, and it's something that we have to be mindful of.
I thank you so much for educating us. We need to hear this for sure. And I'm running out of time. Supervisor Cohen, and then we have a commercial, and then we'll go.
Supervisor Cohen. The point that Jamie brought up an interesting point about being characteristically quiet. However, I felt compelled. You guys have exercised the height of civility. So I would like to just draw your attention to why we're here. And that's, we want to encourage folks to vote. We want to encourage folks to vote. Those of you who are taking this, please, 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 don't wait. Voting has actually started now. But of significance is a very special part of our family, our population. We'd like to send a shout out to our young people, encourage them to get engaged, be the change that they want to see, but we also want to make sure that we leave none behind. And for those which dismay implies, please back up out of my face. Back it up. If you are on probation,
yes,
off parole, you have a right to vote. You can register and you can vote when you are awaiting a trial. You are on trial. You have a misdemeanor conviction. Your felony is suspended. You are on probation. You have completed your sentence.
Vote in this upcoming election. So if you are not registered, you really should consider voting or registering by October 20th deadline.
I'm a single, got a single mom, only child, latchkey kid, kind of roam in the streets of San Francisco, and you know, went to the Boys and Girls Club as a young kid, went on the trips to Camp Mendocino, and then my mom told me about this wilderness program. Kind of keep me out of trouble that these police officers were having on these trips to Yosemite, and I landed there and met a couple mentors, and that was at age 11, 12, 13. These mentors kept me out of trouble for many, many years. I joined the police department at 21. I've spent my whole life, a whole adult life in the police department since my 23rd year. And what I want to say is that, you know, you want to hear from me on behalf of the department, and I'm going to say that I'm going to say ditto, okay? I'm going to say everything that has been said here tonight, yes, absolutely. Education, a priority. You know, jobs, a priority. If you heard Chief Greg Sir talk this summer, jobs, jobs, jobs. That's what he instilled in all of us in the department. Let's get folks employed so that they can stay active and be productive and work. Yeah, absolutely. And, sir, you made the comment about, you know, police have a role. Yeah, we have a role, you know, but our big role is collaboration, not to use a lot of the same words. It's the partnership. It's how can we be also a part of this community. I live in San Francisco. I'm raising my three kids here, okay? I'm not leaving the city. I'm committed to the city, and I'm not going to live anywhere else because this is home. So it's the police officers working in partnership with the community to try to work and facilitate all the things that we've talked about here tonight. And if it comes to enforcement and incarceration and all that, it means that we've all failed, right?
Right.
It means that we all haven't hit the mark, including us. That's the last thing that we want to do. And we like to see the success stories. And so that's my position on all of this evening. And thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Sure. You know, sure. I want to go back to
and yet, an African-American child is better off going to Oakland Unified, a low-performing school district, than they are at San Francisco Unified.
Wow.
And for every year that an African-American child is in San Francisco Unified, the achievement gap between that child and everyone else grows.
Wow.
And I believe that what we need is, first, a recognition that this is a crisis, and we need a Marshall Plan for the education of African-American children in San Francisco. And I haven't seen that level of urgency from the Board of Supervisors, and I believe that a change is needed. And one thing that I would say, and I want to thank actually Commissioner Mendoza, because we have been working to close the achievement gap in the mission with the Mission Promise Neighborhood Program, which actually injected $6 million a year for the next 5 years to change the performance of the four lowest performing schools. We need to do the same thing for the African-American kids in the Bayview. And the, where is it?
Right.
Where is it? Where is it?
I
am sorry. I was the general counsel for the school district. I think I know the school district as well as anyone in this room. Where is that with the African American kids? It hasn't been there. You know, in fact,
let me ask this question. Are some of these issues like bigger than the local school district or bigger than the local leaders? In other words, sometimes we talk about big issues that are global or even national and put it at the footstep of the local leaders.
Like
I'm wondering if they got in place. One at a time. I'm sorry.
Correct.
right. The work that has happened, with particularly right. if you look at emission problem zones. But there are some things that are happening in Bayview. Remember, we had what we call superintendent zones in the Mission and in Bayview. Both federally funded, only for a few years. Funding is gone from both from that program. And if you look at the disbursement of the dollars, the Mission schools actually got more money from the federal government. A couple of superintendent zone schools in the Bayview didn't even receive funding, but they were still categorized under superintendent zone. So the one thing that we are doing, actually working with Meta, who is the lead on the Mission Promise Zone, is to expand the Promise Zone through Bayview, all the way up to even Chinatown possibly, so that we can capture those resources and bring them into to the Bayview community. Because, like you said, it's bigger than just what the school district has the ability to do, but the leveraging piece is very, very, very important. And the last thing I just want to say, I think Supervisor Campos is reading my notes, because I really wanted to go back to the fact that education is the equalizer. How can a peanut farmer become an inventor? How can two children of immigrants become what a supervisor representative? It's the education piece, and that is important, and that's why we have to make sure all of our students have a quality education. But we are doing work. It's going to take a lot more work, and you're right. We have to be intentional. That's why I don't say opportunity gap. I say achievement gap, because that's really what it is. Graduation rates are up in San Francisco, but guess what they're not up for? They're not up for black kids. And so we need to work on doing some things different. School day programming, and there's some examples we can actually take from open in terms of what we are doing, because we do have to be intentional about that.
Thank you, sir. Okay, I'm sorry. Sean,
I want to go back to what Campos said. He's absolutely right. And just to see, like, we have the highest African-American rate dropout. And guess what grade they're starting off at? Fifth grade. Malcolm X have the lowest enrollment in any school in District 10. That's sad. That's unacceptable. When you have Hunter's View right next door to that school with a population of over 600 and some residents with kids living there, that's unacceptable.
What do you mean low enrollment? I don't get that point.
They're from 365 kids to 125 kids. That's unacceptable. You know what I'm saying? We have teachers teaching classrooms of 5 to 10 kids. So we have to do better than that. You know what I'm saying? What are we doing? We're not addressing that need. We have a supervisor that's been there for 4 years. As Ed said, and it hasn't been addressed. So where are we at?
Ed, I'm sorry. Forgive me. Okay. I'm sorry. Thank you. So this is a national issue. So this is, and we're talking about historic institutional racism that's plagued our public school systems for many, many, many years. And we're talking, you know, special ed is where kids with behavioral issues went. You know, we're tracking with something that we've done historically. So we're trying to reverse so much of this without funding. So let's kind of frame this in some of the challenges that we have in the district. Now, sadly, and one of the things that I'm somewhat proud of is that we've actually seen some double-digit growth for African-American and Latino students over the last 4 or 5 years. And there's been an infusion of very targeted services and resources that we want to be able to put into those services. But the other thing that we're doing in partnership is My Brother's Keeper. So, you know, this is, again, something that everybody's been talking about, but nobody wants to organize around. So now we have an initiative. We've hired Theo Miller in the city to help lead all of this work. I mean, we finally have a designated person in the city that's going to be leading this work, and we're doing the same at the school district. We've all made pledges, we're all making commitments, we're already doing planning, and we already have philanthropy behind to help support the work that we want to do around that.
Thank you.
I'm going to kind of piggyback on that.
That is, the city decides that it needs that money more than the school district, and that money ends up going to the city. But the reality is, like Mark is saying, these are our kids. They're not just, you know, I don't have kids in the public school system, but every child in the city is also a child, you know, that the Board of Supervisors of the city is responsible for shepherding through the education process. And when those students, when we did raise the A through G curriculum and we did expect higher standards to prepare our kids for college, we found out that 2,000 of those juniors were not on track to graduate. And we knew that the credit recovery programs were not in place, they weren't funded, and that's why we introduced the supplemental appropriation of $2.2 million to make that happen. Unfortunately, part of that was mine, as you know, but, you know, we were able to come to an agreement that opened up a larger conversation about how important public school funding is, and that it's not just the school district's responsibility, it is the city's responsibility.
So let me jump in here, because we're out of time now, and we have 5 minutes left, and what I'm going to do, starting at the very end, with Supervisor Chu's representative, and it's each of you to just quickly, out of respect for time, respond to this question. What does your San Francisco look like 15 years from today? What does your San Francisco look like 15 years from today? And how will you create that San Francisco as an elected official? How will you work with others at this table or throughout the city to make it happen? What does your San Francisco look like 15 years from today? How will you create that San Francisco as an elected official? How will you work with others at the table to make it happen? Three questions, begin.
Well, Supervisor Hugh, many of you know, I've got the opportunity to answer that question at the top, so rather than take everyone else's time, I'll make sure everyone else has the fair opportunity to answer as well. But this time, let's go over, I'm happy.
Well, I actually think the question facing San Francisco is, will there be a middle class in San Francisco?
Yeah. Do you think there will be? As knowing what you know, doing what you do, in the position you're in, do you think that's the pattern?
Well, I think that my campaign and the campaign of the progressive candidate you see on this table is about ensuring that there is a middle class. And I want to urge people to go out and vote. Because this election is, I think, the most important election we've seen in a generation. And what I can tell you is that in the assembly race, the corporate interests that just got a $25 million tax break, some of the same investors are spending $500,000 against my campaign. And so if you believe that working people deserve a place, a seat at the table, I urge you to get involved in my campaign. We're 26 days away. The reason the money interests are spending so much money against me is because they know that my vision is for San Francisco to keep its diversity, its working people, its poor people, its middle class.
Thank you so much. Ed, 15 years, you're elected. Who will you work with?
Whether I'm elected or not, right? Because it really speaks to the work that I've been doing for the last 10 years. It's been a work that's been structured around the whole question of equity. And this is not a new idea. This is an idea that has driven my work in regards to foreclosures, public housing, economic development, you know, all of the things that I know how to do and the things that I've been trained for. And 15 years from now, what I hope to see and what I will continue to fight for is a more diverse San Francisco, because right now, when you think about it, San Francisco is a majority-minority city. But we have the haves and the have-nots. There's the income inequality that's there and the wealth inequality that's there. So what I would hope to do is to effectuate policies, whether in office or out of office, you know, by you know, blood, sweat, and tears, you know, to bring about a more equitable San Francisco. And to me, I'm under no illusion that it's going to be easy. It's going to be a fight. And I'm prepared for that fight. And I take on all comers. I tell people, if they're looking for me, you can find me on 3rd and Blue, right?
It's all right.
Bring your crew and I'll bring my crew.
Thank you. Thank you,
everyone,
for being a part of this conversation. To the sponsors, it's been by far one of the best organized conversations that we have. And I think that having an opportunity not just to talk in an echo chamber with just District 10 residents and candidates, but also to expand the conversation with school board. You know, I wish you could have had College Board here.
I did, but she flaked on it.
Well, there's more than just one, but because the conversation here, I think there's one thing that is definitely unanimous is that no one system, no one job, no one person, whether they're in office or out of office, has the ability, the authority, and the resources to do it. What's critical is that we pull together these resources and leverage each other. And so when I think about the future of San Francisco, I'm thinking about a diverse part of San Francisco that is ethnically diverse, but also paying attention to quality public education so that we are graduating those that are slipping through the cracks. African American males or Latinos or Samoans in particular. I want to make sure that we're also, with the housing that we're in the process of entitling and getting built, is not just speaking to just affordable low income or affordable housing, but we also need to be having a diverse housing mixture and housing structure so that San Francisco continues to thrive. I'd like to see teachers to be able to remain here. I'm not looking for any more Ellis Act evictions. I would like to see nurses and firefighters and police officers that serve this community remain in this community so that their kids are also in school with folks that are living in public housing. And also what's critical is safety. Safety is number one, whether you define it as police, not police safety, but gun violence or gang violence. We we also need to make sure that we're prepared for that big one. So if that disaster hits, we need to expand our definition of public safety so that we are all covered. And thank you. I hope that you will consider me and come work with me on my campaign.
Thank you.
My name is Malia.
Thank you so much.
I want to thank everybody for coming out. Thank you, Ms. Hewitt, Ms. Dex.
Miss Hewitt to you now.
So, my name is Sean Richard. I'm a father of three kids, two in which graduated from high school. I got a 14-year-old who just started and is giving me
hair. We have the most land, we have the most children, we have the most private investment in zip code 94107. But we also have the highest unemployment, we have the worst infant mortality, and we have the worst violence. It is the most unequal district in the most unequal city in America, and that is why we are here tonight for the equity debate, which is a brilliant idea, and thank you, USF, for having that. But we need change, and we need leadership to execute that. Yes, all these problems are bigger than any one person can solve, but if there's one person who needs to work full-time on issues of inequality, it is the supervisor in District 10. And that's why there are four challenges to the supervisor, because we have not seen them. And today, a child born in Beijing can expect to live 14 years less than a child born on Russian Hill. In 15 years, we cannot be having a conversation. In 15 years, we need to say, what were we thinking during the early part of the 2010s?
What were you doing?
When we were chasing money instead of trying to provide for all our people. That is what we need to be doing, and we have measurable outcomes to show that in terms of the diversity of our city, the economic vibrancy of our city, and the equality in our city. There are ways to measure that. We need to stop forgetting about it like we've been doing for the last 4 years.
Thank you so much.
I just have to say that I am held proud that my boss and our team have done not only the district-wide, so I'm looking forward to another 4 years having her lead the way for better jobs for our city, whether it's a minimum wage that's higher than $15 an hour, which is a possibility, or whether it's building off of the work around the Fair Chance Act and ensuring that everyone in our city has an opportunity for a job that's a good paying job. Whether it's tackling the 72 liquor stores that we have in the Tenderloin for, which we've already closed.
72.
Which is in the desert, and converting all of those to grocery stores that actually provide for our residents in the Tenderloin and the surrounding neighborhoods. Whether it's ensuring that we have South Beach condo owners that come up to the Tenderloin and advocate for pedestrian safety projects and vice versa all throughout the city, because we do have the highest number of pedestrian fatalities and collisions in the entire city. Whether it is ensuring that there's development on the west side, love to see that. Whether it's ensuring that we have more pay housing, transitional age youth housing projects like the Harrison project, like Edward II, and standing up to the residents that frankly would like to see that not happen. Standing up to residents that come out and say, I don't want a homeless shelter in my neighborhood. Well, guess what? We have 1,500 shelter beds and we have 6,000 homeless people. So, we as a city also need to figure out how we can work together, and with our neighborhood residents, we talk a lot about engagement, but it's also, we have to stand up to our residents sometimes and say, this is not, what our values are as a city.
Thank you. Emily.
Emily Rasse, Vice President of the School Board, speaking of second term. The mayor talks about San Francisco as the innovation capital of the world. The school board spent this past year visioning what graduates should look like in 2025. They should be tech savvy, they should know a second language, and they should be culturally competent so they can talk to anyone from all over the world, do business, educate anyone from all over the world. My father was a son of immigrant sharecroppers from Japan. He grew up dirt poor in the Central Valley, and it was through public education that he was able to get his advanced degree and finally become a professor of social work at San Francisco State for many years. I want to make sure that our system continues to allow each one of our 57,000 kids the same opportunities to come from various backgrounds, but be successful and to carry on with their dreams. I ask you for your vote.
Thank you so much. Come on, we get to finish this up.
Thank you. One, I want to thank Supervisor Cohen for her shout out to historically black colleges and universities. I think they're still very important and prevalent to this day. I just want our children to be successful. That's the bottom line for me. I want them to go to world-class schools in this world-class city. I want our schools to develop and prepare our students for every opportunity. Higher education, careers
allowed me to live, work, and stay in San Francisco, pipelines to building a trade community, pipelines to City College of San Francisco. I want to make sure that our businesses here in San Francisco are responsible. We want to make sure that if you make money in the city, provide resources to our schools, provide resources to make sure that our children receive what they need. There's no excuse for us not to make sure that our students here, we have 10% less child population than the national average. There's no excuse for this world-class city not to be providing world-class schools and services to our students. That's what I want to see in 15 years. That's why I'm running for Board of Education, to do my part in making sure our students receive quality education.
Thank you all. Thank you all. Thank you all.